I'll be covering off on some interesting findings from the 2014 season, where Kevin Moore visited a large number of crops and found an unexpected amount of Ascochyta blight. That's the pathogen, that's the disease caused by Foma rabii in chickpeas. And he thought this was particularly worth covering off at this update because of the implications for the coming 2015 season and wanting to understand what had gone on in the 2014 season, which was quite dry, but had an unexpected amount of Ascochyta. So just to remind you about how serious Ascochyta can be in some seasons, here's a photograph from 2010 with lots of disease foci here in September. This crop was eventually lost to a combination of Ascochyta and Botrytis grey mould. So moving on from that unpleasant reminder, our take-home messages. Firstly, the pathogen is variable, so there is differences between isolates and areas, and some isolates are a little bit more aggressive than other isolates. But there's no evidence that isolates interact specifically against particular chickpea varieties such as Hattrick. So there's no evidence for a virulence structure, there's no evidence for pathotypes. So that's good news. In terms of the implication for the coming season, because of the amount of inoculum produced in some areas in 2014, Kevin is recommending that all varieties with less resistance, with a lower resistance rating than Hattrick, receive a preventive fungicide before the first post-emergence rain. And that includes the variety Hattrick as well for that special treatment. And in areas where Ascochyta wasn't found, it's just the normal recommendations in terms of when your first application should be made. So how much Ascochyta was there in 2014? Well, Kevin visited 332 crops. 62 of them had Ascochyta, so that's almost 19%. Now, most of those crops were Hattrick, but Hattrick is also the most commonly grown variety, so that wasn't, we don't think there's something special going on with Hattrick there. And if you look back to 2013 and 2012, only 2% and just over 5% of crops had Ascochyta infection. So it really is a large increase in the 2014 season. Where were those crops? 58 of them were in New South Wales and 4 were in Queensland. We think that there probably was more infected crops in Queensland, but there wasn't as many people looking at crops in Queensland, so that's why that result may be so. Where were the crops in these areas? They ranged from Yellaroy down to Forbes. So quite a wide coverage. Now, why did that Ascochyta occur? We know it was a low rainfall season, quite dry, but an infection event only requires about 1 millimetre of rain if the canopy stays moist for a few hours. On top of that, we also know that all varieties get infected by Ascochyta regardless of their resistance ranking or rating, they are still capable of sustaining some infection. So any volunteers of any variety can support inoculum over the summer and support inoculum. So let's look at the number of rain days. For example, here in Goondiwindi, in the blue we have the number of rain days for the 2014 season, and in the orange we have the number of rain days from June through to November for the long-term average. And for the 2014 season, we have between 1 and 4 rain days a month through these few months. And in particular, if it rains in the early evening, then the canopy is going to stay wet overnight, even if there's only been 1 or 2 millimetres of rain. So that would provide enough moisture for an infection event to start. Where did the inoculum come from to infect these crops in 2014? The inoculum survives on seed, volunteers, and chickpea residues. So firstly, was seed an inoculum source? Kevin's records from 2012 and 2013 show that he didn't find any crops where the pods were infected. So there was a low likelihood of pod infection acting as an inoculum source for the 2014 season. He also got hold of some seed lots that were used to sow crops in the 2014 season that had this unexpected level of infection. And he got almost a zero level of infection when looking at those seed samples. So he didn't think that seed source was a contributing factor for this unexpected infection in 2014. But in terms of residues, looking at the weather records for the previous seasons, in particular the summers, the 2012 to 2013 and 2013 to 2014 seasons, they're pretty dry summers. So that might have allowed the residue to persist for longer because it wasn't breaking down as fast and act as a bit of a bridge. And there may have also been volunteers around that act as a bridge. And if we look at the Goondiwindi rainfall for 2014, from January through to the end of the year, we see that in March, there was certainly quite a large rain event that would be enough to establish a cohort of volunteers. And that type of event did occur in some other areas as well. So it may be that volunteers, the combination of volunteers and residues from these previous crops contributed to this infection that was found in 2014. A few photographs from some of these 2014 crops here in Galandra. This field here to your left was in chickpeas in 2013. And apparently the header was moving in this direction here, and there's a nice northerly blowing that was blowing the dust from the header back into that field. And I don't know how it shows up from where you're sitting, but you might be able to see a bit of a patch running out through here that's actually in an infection gradient of Ascochyta. So here we have inoculum as dust and powder coming off the header, getting blown into the field that was then sown in 2014 and the disease turning up in 2014. So that's an example of that, of where the inoculum might have come from for that crop. Sorry, I don't know the answer to that question, but I don't think it was a serious, Kevin hasn't talked about serious yield losses in the 2013 season. And that's another thing to note about this 2014 season was that although Kevin found a lot of Ascochyta, in general it didn't contribute to yield losses, it was well managed and remained as localised small areas within the field. And I'll come back to that again at the end of the talk. Another photograph from 2014 here at Yalloroy, and apparently this is about as severe as most of the infections look, small localised areas. As Kevin visited fields, he collected isolates from as many fields as he could, and he then included these isolates in a pathogenicity experiment, which I'll move on to now, trying to identify if Ascochyta from some regions was more aggressive or pathogenic than Ascochyta from other regions in order to answer this question. Was there something different happening in 2014? Was there a new isolate around that was causing more disease? We've got some selected results here. We've got an isolate from Darling Downs collected by Mal Riley in 2010. We've got the Yalloroy isolate from that same photograph that I just showed you. And we've got four cultivars, varieties ranging from a susceptible to a resistant variety rating. This one here is one of the parents of Boundary. What you can see is that this Yalloroy isolate was quite aggressive. We have stem breakage, quite severe disease across the four varieties. And the Darling Downs isolate, quite severe stem breakage here. Now these two plants here, you can see a little bit of damage to the petiole there. And apparently if you looked at these plants very closely, you could see some infection. So the key point here is that the isolates differed in their aggressiveness. Some isolates could cause more disease on some varieties, but all varieties were infected. So it's about the amount of disease the isolate caused. So there's no evidence for a virulent structure. There's no evidence for pathotypes. It's simply that some isolates do a little bit more work in terms of how much tissue they damage. So it's, that gives us confidence that nothing had happened to the hat-trick variety by a new isolate coming along that was now preferentially able to damage hat-trick to excessive levels. Nothing like that was happening. To give you confidence that nothing with a particular isolate was happening, we've got results here from a yield trial with a variety management practice where the trial was inoculated with 23 isolates, including that aggressive Yellowroy isolate. Now these are the yields for these five varieties. They're all over 2 tonne, following 5 1-litre chlorothalonil applications. If we compare that to the untreated control, Kyabra was smashed, no yield at all possible off those plants. But these varieties here with improved resistance to Ascochyta all yielded at over 1,500 kilograms with no treatment. So that aggressive isolate was included in this experiment, and you can see that you still got fairly reasonable yields despite the effect of these this isolate mixture. Finally, there was also a variety management practice treatment included, which included a 0.5-litre chlorothalonil rate, and the number of applications differed per variety. So Kyabra had 5, and the more resistant the variety, the less the number of applications. The details of that are on the book. But you can see that the 0.5-litre application did pretty well in most cases. Finally, one more aspect which may affect Ascochyta management in the 2015 season is seed purity. So here we've got a photograph of hat-trick that was grown. You can see a pink flag in the middle here and a bit of a line. Hat-trick was grown, and the seed from that hat-trick there came from a grain merchant with a certified seed source. This is what the farmer planted from his own seed source on this side here. And 3 years ago, he had grown Yorker and hat-trick, and at the end of that season 3 years ago, thought he had sold all his Yorker. But Kevin considers that this variety here was probably Yorker. You can see quite a difference here. So the point here is that if you've got a crop that you think is hat-trick, but it's actually Yorker and you're managing it as hat-trick, you're not going to get the same success in terms of Ascochyta management in a heavy Ascochyta season. So knowing about seed purity will have implications for the success of 2015 Ascochyta management. So in conclusion, our take-home messages. For the 2015 season, we recommend the sowing of quality seed with a known seed purity. And for areas where Ascochyta occurred in 2014, we recommend the application of preventative fungicide before the first post-emergence event for all varieties with a rating less than hat-trick, and include hat-trick in that application. But if you're in a locality where there was no Ascochyta in 2014, normal management practices apply. Thank you.